you that have joined us in this Lunch and Learn today, hosted by Career Services. We're excited that you've taken time out of your day to join. And again, the topic, Career Fair Success, Developing Your Elevator Pitch, Resume, and LinkedIn Profile. A couple housekeeping items I wanted to mention is feel free to turn your cameras on if you'd like, but if not, that's fine too. If you want to ask questions, go ahead and pop them in the chat, and Katie is going to be monitoring that, and we'll either address them during the presentation or at the end. This session, just so you know, is being recorded, and we will be sending a link out in the next few days with the recorded link to everybody that has joined and those that have not joined as well, but have signed up for it. So with that being said, I want to go ahead and introduce myself, tell a little bit about myself, as well as introduce, and Katie will introduce herself. So again, my name is Cheryl Carr. I work as a career services advisor and outreach coordinator in our department in career services. And I have had the absolute pleasure and opportunity to work with students and alumni for approximately over 15 years. So it's been a long time. My passion is to assist you with your job search, connect you with employers, and that's a passion of our department. So I'm really excited that you're here and that we're really hoping that you'll find value in this presentation. So Katie, why don't you go ahead and introduce yourself?
So, hello, everybody. First and foremost, thanks for jumping on. We're hoping you'll get quite a good amount of information from this presentation. And with that, so yes, my name is Caitlin Molesky. I am the Director of Career Services here at Walsh College. I've been at Walsh for just shy of about a year. Prior to that, I worked in government, so I did a lot of law and legal for about 8 years. I worked in human resources, and then I worked in workforce development for a handful of years as well. I'm also a college professor over at Macomb, Oakland, St. Clair County Community College, as well as Walsh. And so we're looking forward to sharing some information with you. And as Cheryl mentioned, just pop anything you have in the chat. We'll definitely address that as we're going through the presentation.
Okay, thanks, Katie. Well, I'm going to go ahead and share my screen and we'll get going on the presentation. So before I start, I wanted to talk a little bit. Excuse me. Where's to get this slide going? Excuse me. There we go. A little bit about the services that we provide as to you as a student, as also as an alumni. It's a lifetime service that you can use forever and ever. In fact, just the other day, I just connected with alumni that had been to Walsh since 1997. So we find it really rewarding that we can go back and help you over the years after you graduate. We provide one-on-one assistance through Zoom, phone, in person, as well as email. And as you can see, these are the types of services that we provide, anything related to your job search. Resume reviews, that's a very popular item that students and alumni would like to meet with us. So we will help you develop an excellent targeted resume. Career fair preparation, networking, as we all know how important networking is in your job search, attending events, cover letters. If you have an interview coming up, interview practice, LinkedIn profile reviews, overall career coaching, if you have questions on your major, what's the industry out there? So anything, again, related to your job search, our department is here to support you and work with you, whether it's through appointments, and we try to make it convenient for you and make evening appointments as well. So with that being said, I want to talk to you about our excellent job database, where if you have an employer that wants to post with Walsh, they post it in Walsh CareerLink. If you have not signed up and filled out your profile and have an up-to-date email in Walsh CareerLink, you definitely want to do that. That is how we communicate with our students and alumni. And if you at any point have unsubscribed to Walsh CareerLink, make sure that you go in there and subscribe again to our emails. This database, as I mentioned, a lot of alumni post jobs, and you can find jobs anywhere from internships for entry-level students while you're pursuing your education, or for alumni, if you're looking for a senior-level position. Just the other day, we had an employer that wanted to post a controller role. So you really will find a variety of jobs posted in Walsh CareerLink, as well as in various industries. Go in there, you know, learn it. Use this as one resource in your overall job search. Again, that's Walsh CareerLink. I don't know, Katie, if you want to pop that link in the chat. That way, you know, if you haven't signed up or updated it, please do.
It is in the chat.
Thank you. So I'm going to review a little bit about our 2024 events coming up. And this is our first monthly lunch and learn today. We'll having another one in February 13th. Hope you can join us then. That one's going to be on networking, and we're going to have a Walsh alumni join us from Lear Corporation, who is an excellent networker internally, her internal in her organization as well as external. We have our internship coming up. It's right around the corner, our internship connection. We have about 20 employers registered right now. And that's February 7th. Here's an IT cybersecurity connection, February 21st, our spring career fair, May 15th, and again, our fall career fair, September 11th. These events are so important for you to attend. This is where you can meet with employers. You can connect with them, find out about job opportunities. So you'll find me saying a few times in the presentation how important it is for you to show up at these events where we create opportunities for you. At our previous career fair in October, we had over 60 employers in attendance. And again, why attend these events? First, it's going to help you build your network. You're going to learn about companies that are in attendance. You could create a job opening for yourself and learn about future job openings. As we all know, the key to finding a job is to get it before it's posted, and that's through networking. So you're going to have the opportunity to network with an employer and learn about career paths, learn about a company culture, the company culture. So this is a one-on-one opportunity for you to connect with an employer and hiring manager, as well as recruiters. It also is that you're going to get feedback on your resume. How important is it to get feedback from a recruiter? This is what they do all day long, is review resumes, and they can give you some feedback on your document. Practice. It also gives you practice in your interviewing and in communication skills, and hopefully builds your confidence. So when you do have that interview, you know, you've met with employers, and it's so important to practice and be able to talk about yourself to employers. So if you're learning to learn more about different careers and industries, you can actually talk with an employer one-on-one and ask questions. And again, asking educated questions and questions that you've really that have thought out that is so important to have prepared for these career fairs. So prior to the event, where do I start? First of all, you want to develop a targeted resume. And again, we're here to assist you with that. You want to update your LinkedIn profile. An employer, you know, they're going to Google you. They're going to see what you have on LinkedIn. So you want to do that prior to the career fair. Develop your elevator pitch. That's so important. Again, you use these at the career fair, networking events, any type in an interview, you know, answering that question, you know, tell me about yourself. And that is important that you have that ready to go. You want to research the employers in attendance on the website. We do on our website, we have the employers that are, you know, that are in attendance, as well as what positions you're recruiting for. But I always tell students and alum, go talk to that employer, even if they haven't listed a position that you're looking for, because this is another opportunity to expand your network. Apply to positions prior to attending the event, because sometimes employers would say, well, the positions are posted on the website. Well, how good do you look if you say, you know what, I've already applied to that position, and, you know, so you're prepared. And also asking questions, I just mentioned that, how important that is, but asking informed questions and have them written down, ready to go before. Another suggestion is to bring a friend. Think about, do I have a friend that I can bring that's going to boost my confidence and that we can, you know, iron sharpens iron, right? So, and it'll just help you feel more comfortable and maybe get some of those nerves out. So also you want to dress professional in a professional manner. And, you know, when I say that, this is, again, the actual day of the event, but you do want to have clothes prepared. You want to make sure, you know, when it comes to your grooming, is, you know, your nails, your hair, your makeup, all of that. You want to have professional dress. Dress like you would for an interview. I know we live in a little bit more of a casual environment right now, but it's really important that you look professional, like you would for an interview, a suit, in a cologne. You don't want to put cologne or perfume on too strong. That could be a turnoff to an employer. So bring a pad folio where you can hold your resumes, your business cards that you collect, a pencil, paper where you can take notes. Then, you know, you can, when you talk to an employer and you leave that booth, you want to be able to have something to jot notes down. So again, a pad folio will provide all that. Bring plenty of resumes, bring more than you need. Bring in a resume for every employer and make sure they're printed out on quality resume paper. If you have a 2-page resume, you may staple the second page, you know, staple it together or print it on front and back. So you want to make sure you do, if you have a 2-page resume, you do that so you don't just give them one page or they don't lose it amongst all the papers they collect. And introduce yourself confidently, of course, but you know, you want to, this is your first impression that, so you want to have a firm handshake. You want to have good eye contact, smile. So this, I think that first and last impression is so important when you walk up to that employer booth. And also, again, have you at that elevator pitch ready to go. But when you walk up to that employer, you want to just don't want to go right into that elevator pitch. You want to try to connect with them and make that connection and have a conversation. So make your elevator pitch hopefully natural and conversational. And then, you know, in the employer and as you exchange, you want to make sure you're listening and you really have some good thought out responses and, you know, before you answer them. Ask for a business card so that you can follow up. That is key, is following up. Is for some reason they say they don't have a business card, you know, apply on the website, make sure you get their name, you know, write it down when you leave or whatnot or at the booth and follow up on LinkedIn. So that, again, that shows interest and that this way you're able to carry on that conversation even after the event. So the actual day of the event, it's here at the Troy campus. You usually, you know, park on the north side of the building, walk in the usually glass doors, but we have multiple doors you can come through. But you want to check in at the Career Services table first. I would suggest you arrive early just so you know, have your game plan and you're ready to go. Career Services table, we will have a name tag for you to fill out. We'll give you a map of the event. And again, we will help you in any way we can, direct you to employers, make any suggestions on companies to apply to. But hopefully you've done your research ahead of time. That is so important that you've researched the employers that you want to talk to so that when you do talk to that employer, that you really have some good questions for them and show that you've done your research. But consider every contact that you meet at the career fair an interview. Even if you have a short conversation, this is an opportunity that could lead you, land you a job or to go to the next step in an interview. Also, I want to mention, when we have our career fair, that a lot of times students are talking amongst each other and trying to connect. So try to really keep an open mind about meeting new people, not only employers, but other students or alumni that may have attended the event. And this can just be, again, another support system and opportunity for you to network. We do have a career services table that we, you know, have at the event. And we do offer any type of insight or on-site coaching that you know, if you need practice in developing your elevator pitch or anything like that, just know that we are there for you and we're rooting for you and cheering you on.
Cheryl, if you don't mind, I just jump in
No,
for a minute.
please do.
With the career fairs, one thing to keep in mind is those employers that are attending the event, you have a captive audience. Those employers are going to be there for the next 2.5 hours, and they are there specifically because they want to talk to you. So if you've ever kind of had that experience where you're reaching out to employers, you're emailing, you're calling them, and you're thinking, I'm not getting a response from anybody. This is kind of one of those areas where these people are here wanting to talk, and they are sitting there at a table with nowhere to go. So put on your best elevator pitch and make sure you're having those conversations. But remember that they're there because they want you to be, and they want to be, and they want to have those conversations. And so one of the greatest things that we always hear from the employers is they always say, this is the place. This is who we want to talk to. And the students that are coming here have very good opportunities to network and engage and learn about the opportunities that we're hiring for, not just now, but in the future. So just kind of keep that in mind as you're going through the career fair, that no employer is a bad employer. They all have different departments. If they're not hiring now, it could be later, but they are here and it's an opportunity, especially if it's an employer that maybe you haven't been able to get a contact for. This is a perfect opportunity to not only talk to them, but maybe get that contact and build that connection moving forward for yourself.
Absolutely. Thanks, Katie. And what she said is so true. And also, if you know, you'll see on our website what they're recruiting for, what positions that are listed. But honestly, again, that it's so important to talk to all the employers. Students will come back sometimes to us and say, and they just need some encouragement. And I'll encourage them to go back into that room, talk to more employers. Use that. That's why I said arrive early. Use that entire time to connect with employers. And it's exhausting, I know, but it's so important. In fact, I just want to tell a quick story. At our last career fair, there was an alumni that from General Motors that was on the recruiting side. And she came up to me at the end of the event and said, you know what? If you had told me not to go back in there, if you had not told me to go back to that General Motors table and talk to them, because she wasn't planning on it, I wouldn't have this job. I wouldn't be back recruiting at Walsh. And so if you see me at that career fair, I'm going to tell you multiple times, go back in there, talk to the employers. So she had a great success story, and I just loved hearing that. So this, getting back a little bit to your elevator pitch. And so basically it answers tell me about yourself question, right? And you have that question, whether you're in a networking event, or whether you're at a career fair, you're in an interview. So you want to have that answer well-prepared. And just to go over a few things that are really important when you're thinking about when you develop that elevator pitch is really keep it concise, 30 to 60 seconds or so. But that elevator pitch is what's going to make a lasting impression to an employer. So ask yourself, you know, what sets you apart from other, you know, from your competition? So and your other job seekers. So you want it to make it clear and concise, communicate your education, your work experience, or an internship app that you may have had. Talk about your strengths, as well as a position that you're seeking and why you want to work for that company. So the best thing is write it out, practice it so it becomes natural, conversational. You want to use descriptive statements on your skills and abilities, but again, it's relatively short. And again, when we have that elevator pitch, you're at an event, you want it to naturally flow into the conversation as you talk to those recruiters and employers. I have a sample elevator pitch, and I was going to ask if anybody would like to read it out loud or just volunteer. I don't know if there's anybody in there that would. If not, I will read it myself.
I'll read it.
Thank you, Frankie.
My name is John Davidson. I'm a senior at Walsh College, majoring in business administration and marketing. While attending college, I have worked as an intern for an advertising firm. I possess excellent social media marketing skills. In addition, I've developed successful campaigns for class projects and student events utilizing Facebook, YouTube, Twitter, Foursquare, Pinterest, Instagram, and LinkedIn. I am interested in an entry-level marketing position at your organization. I believe I would be able to make an immediate contribution to your company.
Okay. Excellent. Thank you, Frank. You did a great job. So again, this is a sample elevator pitch. Yours written. And again, sometimes we'll ask students, you know, if you want to write it out and have another, have us look at it, we're happy to do that. Practice it with us. But again, it is so important to have that prepared. We're kind of going to change gears and talk about the purpose of a resume. And I think that is, like I mentioned earlier, that probably the number one area that students and alumni need help with is they want help developing a resume so they can land the interview. That's the key, right? And you want to show in that resume that you are the best candidate for that position. When an employer looks at your resume, they're going to give it about 30 seconds or less and decide if they're going to go further and possibly call you or continue to read. So your resume needs to be clear, concise, and a very strong document. And again, we're here to help you do that. As when you develop your resume, some things that you want to think about is you want to make sure it's a clean, concise format, easily read by applicant tracking systems, and error-free. One error in your resume, you could miss the opportunity. You want to customize your resume to the requirements of the position. Again, and that's usually found through the job descriptions that you're applying to. The job titles should be aligned in your resume with the positions that you're applying to, as well as the industry if possible. So sometimes job titles, you can change them a little bit. It really depends, but the job titles, the company, and the dates are all so important that the employers are looking for. And you want those keywords from the job description to put naturally into your resume. You don't want them copy and pasted, but you want them throughout your resume in the summary section, in the skills section, in the bullets. Those keywords. You'll find me talking a lot about keywords. It's funny. It's when you develop your resume and you apply to a position. I remember our HR coordinator saying the first process of elimination is someone that doesn't follow directions. So keep in mind, make sure you follow directions for the job you're applying to, every detail of it. So otherwise, you'll be eliminated. We'll talk a little bit about the different resume formats. We've got a chronological, a functional, and a combination. The chronological resume probably is, you know, that's most popular, where you have your most recent work experience first. It's best for individuals that have a more consistent work history and career progression. And I do think employers prefer chronological resumes. A functional resume is really focused on your skills and your qualifications versus recent work experience. A combination or hybrid resume combines the chronological and the functional, and it includes a skill section and shows progression of your career. The functional, again, that is really based on your skills. The combination and hybrid is a combination of both those resumes. I prefer the combination resume versus a functional resume. I'll really try to work with students on that just because it does shows your work experience as well as your key skills. Now with the combinational and functional resume, if you have work gaps, maybe you stayed home with your family, took care of your children, those are definitely more applicable if that's your situation. If you have regular career progression throughout, you know, throughout your resume, you want a definitely more of a chronological. So, and again, we'll help you determine that in career services if you need assistance with that. Applicant tracking system friendly resumes. You hear a lot about that, how important you need to get, you know, your resume is to get through applicant tracking system. So as you, I'm not going to go ahead and read every do and every don't, but some key things, and I know I've talked about how important, you know, having the keywords from the job postings it is, and using like a standard font such as Arial, Calibri, Times New Roman versus some other type of fonts that are not as common. Quantifying achievements. You're going to hear me talk about that. Tailoring your resume to each position. So these are some big do's. Proofread. Make sure you don't have any errors. So in some of the don'ts, you know, you don't want pictures and graphics on your resume. Now, if you're emailing your resume to a person, or you know it's going to be a human that is reading your resume, and maybe you're in graphics or marketing, you can have one of those Canva resumes that, you know, are colorful and have more formats. But if you want to get through these applicant tracking systems, you really need a clean and simple format. You want more of a generic looking resume, but it can look very professional. You don't want, I say avoid headers and footers, abbreviations, especially those that aren't relevant to the industry that you're applying to, and it may not be able to read it. Text boxes, I wouldn't put important information in text boxes. There's better ways to put a skill section outside of an actual text box. So again, applicant tracking system friendly, in general, is really a simple and clean format. And those are the ones, you know, the medium and larger size companies are going to be using these ATS systems.
Just to kind of touch too on one more major don't
to
keep in mind with your resume is if you want to use color, it's okay to use a little bit of color, make things pop, stand out, but make sure it's done tastefully. And one of the things that I always like to mention is do not use a background color. So one of the things, if you don't already know, is that in human resources, when they print your resume, they do not print in color. They will print in black and white. So if you have a gray background, if you have any background, it's going to print as a dark gray. Or if you had a terrible printer like I did at HR, it'll be dark gray and it'll be streaky. And then you can't read the words that are actually over top of it. So always make sure you avoid the background color piece of it. And just keep in mind that what you are visually sending to them might not actually be what the HR recruiter is going to see because of the fact that they're not printing in color. They're going to print black and white. And that's what's going to be in your employee file if you get hired in, or just even the candidate list that they're going to put everybody's resumes in a folder and pass that along to the hiring manager that is in the respective departments. So always be mindful if you're going to use color. Also, do a print version to see what it'll look like when you print in black and white to make sure that it's still tasteful.
Great. Good advice, Katie. Yes, I think I used to use shading more. I've completely taken off. Don't shade, especially when you print it out. It doesn't look very nice. In regards to the resume formatting, you want to keep it brief. A concise, clear resume, but represents your background. And usually one page, two pages, if you have relevant experience over 5 to 7 years, IT resumes, they tend to be longer, as well as CVs in the education industries. Or if you're a director on up, you may have a longer resume, but 1 to 2 page resumes are what you wanna do for a business resume. You wanna include the link to your online portfolio on the top of your resume. And if you, or in your LinkedIn link, if your LinkedIn is complete and you have a strong profile, make sure you edit your LinkedIn link to just have your name. Okay. And we're going to talk a little bit about that in the LinkedIn portion. You want a balance of white space in your resume. So the bottom line is it looks to you want it to look pleasing to the eye and really well laid out and balanced and with white space. So, and remember that hot, I call it the hot zone portion of the resume. That's the very top one third. That's critical that you have that attention grabbing information that's going to want, that recruiter is going to want to continue to read your document. So a concise and compelling summary can be at the top, but again, that's optional. There's a couple different options on how you can present that. That can be a career summary. It can be a headline. It can be with bullets underneath, or it could just, so there are different options and what's best for you and what you like and is key. Bullet the information. I think it's a little bit clearer to read, especially under the experience portion of it. And I know Katie touched on the coloring already, but I think the black and white is pretty standard in resumes. If you do add a touch of color, again, that's optional, but be very careful when they go to print it out. And lastly, if you are a entry-level candidate or you're looking for an internship, you want to make sure you add coursework to your resume, projects. I've done that a lot with our IT students, and they've done a lot of projects in their courses. You want to add GPA. You want to add relevant volunteer experience, any professional organizations that you may be a part of as a student. So depending on, you know, your situation, and somebody that's experienced may not add coursework and projects unless you're making a career transition. Now that's another option. If you are making a career transition, then your education is going to be key.
Can I ask you a question?
Yes.
You mentioned two things that I need to approach. One is, what if you have things in your resume that you can't talk about? Places that you've worked, either because of NDAs or security clearance issues. How do you approach things that you've done in your work experience that are very relevant, but you can't share? And then the other part is volunteer work. I've got a lot to put on my resume, and I've included my volunteer work. I've got around 5,500 hours of volunteer work, and no one ever has ever asked me about it or mentioned it, or like, how really relevant is that? I mean, I'm starting to regret actually doing as much as I have to like, I hate to say no benefit to my own. I felt really good about doing it. But again, I turn around and it's like, they really didn't do anything for me for my resume.
Yeah. Well, in addressing your first questions, you're talking about if you don't have security clearance to share information. I wasn't
really. I worked in a facility for the military that I can't talk a lot about what I did. So how, and it's pretty relevant to some of the jobs that I've applied to, and you know, I'm not allowed to really say anything for another, I don't know, 10 or 20 years or whatever it is, or until somebody waves a flag and says we're good. So, you know, how do you use things in your background like that, or how do you promote yourself in a way that's not breaking the law?
There's got to be some information you could share about your accomplishments and things in those positions, but again, I think it would probably benefit you working with us one-on-one where we could really review that together.
Okay.
Yep.
The kind of short answer to that, yeah. Would also be one of the best ways I would recommend is reach out to the HR department of your employer and ask them, what information am I allowed to share? What title am I allowed to use? Make sure you have it in writing so that way they will tell you, these are the things we're willing to let you talk about for the sake of employment moving forward. And then you can simply be honest and say, hey, you know, this is as much as I can share in terms of my experience, and that's what you have clearance for. But above and beyond that, unfortunately, due to an NDA, I'm not allowed to disclose any further information. So that would probably be the safest way. So you make sure, hey, I have confirmation of this is what I can talk about. And just be upfront with the employer that you're interviewing for, that's exactly why. And then also to address the volunteer work, don't ever feel as if volunteer work is a waste. First and foremost, volunteer work is great just in general for the people that you're helping. But two, depending on the positions and the type of volunteer work that you're doing, one, I would always say just kind of steer clear of anything religious or political in terms of providing that information, just in case the people you're interviewing with disagree with those organizations and what they stand for, whatever that may be. You just want to make sure your volunteer work is for neutral things. But when it comes to that volunteer work, it's great because what can happen too is potentially if you're not working during the times that you're volunteering, it's kind of filling that gap of, well, what are you doing? Are you sitting at home all day hanging out? Or are you out there doing something? Because volunteering could be a networking opportunity to increase your communication skills. It could be a networking opportunity to land your next job. It could be helping you develop any type of clerical typing skills, organizational skills, multitasking skills. So there's a lot that can come of that volunteer work as well that you can put on a resume, or potentially if you're maybe managing in a volunteer role and you're overseeing projects, then you can start talking project management and managerial skill sets, especially if you're trying to advance. So you can get a little creative with your volunteer work, but it is always good to have. But if you couple it with your work experience, you can certainly scale that down a bit, just so it doesn't take so much room on that resume if you have other good qualities in your work experience that you can share.
Yeah.
Yeah, I appreciate that. Thank you.
Yeah. Absolutely.
And the volunteer work, I wouldn't, if it's old volunteer work, I wouldn't include that at all. It should be recent, within the last maybe 3 years or so, in my opinion. You don't want to, people come and they always talk about, well, I volunteered 5 years ago. No, something like that you don't want on your resume. And again, how you present it, as Katie said, you can really scale that down to look very professional on your resume. Maybe you don't list it all. Great question. So we were to talk about a little bit about the headings and the summary. Here we have a heading. And again, it's very targeted to specific positions. It uses the keywords underneath the heading. And this is one option that can be at the top of your resume. You want to keep it short, under 10 words. And I always bold it. I use uppercase when I'm doing a heading at the top of a resume, and it really should be targeted to the job you're applying to. As you write your resume, that's the whole key, is really targeting it to the positions that you're applying to. So this is an example of another heading, and it's got a little bit of summary underneath. For somebody that's seeking a career in marketing, it's more for an entry-level person. I believe they head-to-head has an internship under their belt, and they're using their academic as well as professional experience as keywords in their summary. I don't even shade anymore, but you certainly could. But the bullets should be very lean, results-focused, and using action verbs and keywords. And this is the skill section. As you can observe, a lot of the actual skills that are listed are very targeted to marketing. And you can use your academic coursework in that skill section to attract employers. If you've done it through your schoolwork, definitely can be used in your skill section. And this is the top part of your resume. So you want that recruiter to continue to read. That part needs to be very, very strong, and definitely have a few options on how you present it. We just presented it. That was just one way to do it. So talk about your resume experience. I think that's probably the number one thing it seems like recruiters are interested in. So really we call that the heart of the resume. You want to have your titles, company, location, dates, and include the month, year. You want to relate those job successes, you know, quantify information. Anything that you can include where you've got metrics, percentages. So on this next slide, I'm going to share with you, we talk about that. And again, that lean and clean resume, and you don't want details that really are not relevant to the job you're applying to. So I don't know if you've heard of the CART, which is a challenge action result. So if you want to ask yourself, what was a challenge or problem that you encountered in your position? What action did you take? And what was the result, and how did it benefit the company? So it's almost similar to the STAR method that we talk about at interviewing, but this is to help you really think about those bullets that you're creating on your resume, where you want to include those metrics. Where did you increase the sales? How have you increased productivity? And again, what was a challenge or problem? What action did you take to resolve it? And what was the result for the company? And those are that question is what's going to help you make those impactful, results-oriented bullets for your resume. That's what's going to really set you apart from other job seekers. So this is an example of an entry-level or marketing graduate that had one internship under her belt. And that, again, that's the heart of the resume, that experience. One thing I don't see a lot of numbers in here. If you've got experience, you definitely want to add those metrics in there. This is, you know, clean, it's bulleted. It's got, again, they got the employer and the titles bolded, the dates with the months. This is, again, an entry-level marketing graduate sample. Relevant skills and keywords. It's so important you have those in there again for the applicant tracking system to pick those up. So you review the job description and what specific keywords are they looking for? And again, you want to mention that throughout your resume. You want to include a mix of the keywords in the way of the technical skills, the job-related skills, and soft skills, which are more your interpersonal skills. Because a lot of job descriptions also include a lot of interpersonal skills that they want you to have, such as being a good team member or things along that line, public speaking. And those types of skills you want to put throughout your resume. If that's in the job description, you want to get creative and list that in your resume. You don't want to just copy and paste things from the job description and put them in your resume or specific bullets. You definitely want to create that in a way that really flows naturally. And if you do have like a hybrid resume where you do have a skill section, you can definitely include those in a skill section, those keywords. Changing gear, we're going to go ahead and talk about LinkedIn. That is such an important part of you as a business professional, whether you're looking for a job, you're trying to develop sales lead. There's really so many advantages to have a really strong LinkedIn profile. That is your marketing tool. So helps you in finding a job. It's a great resource. It's an excellent tool. It's a multimedia platform that you can upload information and media about yourself, but you also learn about events and information and on companies as well as other people. You can follow companies and groups on LinkedIn and help you just learn more about your industry news and follow discussions, and allows you to research people. If you're going on an interview, you can research that person that that's interviewing you, as well as if you have a business meeting, you know, learn a little bit about their background. What do you have in common with them? So LinkedIn is invaluable. And also the group section, I find you can connect with a lot of different professionals and contribute to groups. That is a really nice feature through LinkedIn. So when I was developing the presentation, I wanted to include these pictures because I find with so many students and alumni, they haven't really uploaded a professional headshot. And that's so important. You really, as you can see, the top two pictures, they don't look very professional. The bottom two, they're smiling. They've got a nice, simple background, and they look much better. And I would say you want a picture up there, but if it's a picture that's really not a professional picture, I don't know. But your entire LinkedIn profile, when you create it, should be really geared to the next step in your career. And that should, you know, who are you writing your LinkedIn profile, your target audience? And again, it should be aligned with your resume. So information from your resume should be in your LinkedIn profile. You want to maximize all the characters in the various sections of your profile. There is an excellent website as well as Canva that you can change your background on your LinkedIn profile. I will load that in at the end of the presentation, or I'll send it in your follow-up email. So again, the pictures and your background picture are all, you know, that's the first thing an employer or an individual is going to see is the top part. And you really want that professional. Another thing I want to mention is so many people, once they land that job, they don't continue to update their LinkedIn profile. So continually update that. Keep up on it. You know, don't wait for 5 years to update it. You know, stay active. And when you create a strong LinkedIn profile, you can edit your URL. It's important to do that, or it's just your first name and last name, and you do that in the upper right-hand corner of your LinkedIn profile. You're able to do that. And you can actually add that URL to your resume. And again, I would only add it if your LinkedIn is excellent and, you know, ready to go, but it is a nice feature, you know, to put that LinkedIn URL on your resume. I mentioned your background image, and that's optional if you want to change it. I know there are a lot of different pictures out there, and you could align it with your industry and the type of position you're looking for. Your headline is key. You want a strong headline. By default, I know LinkedIn picks up your last job that you had, but you can go in there and edit it and target that headline to the next step you want to go in your career. Your work experience, it's really important to, you know, utilize those keywords under the work experience. Utilize all those characters. Copy and paste your bullets, your accomplishments under your work experience, or you can put a little summary, but just make sure it's complete and those keywords are throughout your LinkedIn profile. Your education, the skills section. So these are like the basics you definitely want for a good, strong LinkedIn profile, as well as an about section. I included a picture of my LinkedIn, and I just wanted to mention that picture was taken at our last career fair. We actually had a LinkedIn photo booth that students and alumni could have pictures taken, and we'll be doing that again in May. So it really is a nice option, and we hope that you take advantage of that when we'll be doing that again. I have my background as Walsh. Again, I have a couple different titles for myself, and you can have several titles and just really target those job titles to the positions you're looking for. That is key. And you can have that open to work option. If you're not working, you definitely don't want to have that on if you're currently working and you don't want your current employer to see it. So, and that contact information, I wanted to mention, you can actually put Detroit metropolitan area and have a wider range and just set of your city state that you live in. It's an option to do that. I did mention that about section. I think that's an important part of your whole LinkedIn profile. You really want to show your passion, first person, written in first person, and just share your professional story. Share your career journey. You want to keep it concise, 1 to 2 paragraphs, and you want to end it with a how someone can contact with, you know, your phone number, your email, you know, a call to connect. Say, let's connect. So your about section is where you can really kind of individualize it. Again, show your passion, and it's an overview of your career, but again, where you're heading towards, what you're targeting at the next step in your career. Write that in your about section. Education and experience, you want to include all that information. If your GPA is a strong GPA, you want to put that in. If you're entry level or making a career transition, you want to put your courseworks, your projects, Add all that, make it complete. Any academic achievements, again, if you're if you've got honors and scholarships, that can go into your LinkedIn profile. So the more complete, the better. If you belong to any professional associations, whether as a student or a professional, add those. So there's a lot of options to add into information and to make sure it's complete. Use your resume as a guideline. We talked about if your volunteer work doesn't fit on your resume, put it in your LinkedIn profile. This is an excellent place to add that additional information that may not be able to fit on your resume. Again, we went over some of those publications. You can add that. You can add your various languages. Say you speak several languages. That could be interesting for an employer. So make sure you go through all those sections and that you have completely filled them out and what's relevant to you and targeted again to that next step that you want to go in your career. I guarantee that employers are checking your LinkedIn profile before they interview you, where they meet you. So it is really, really important. Oftentimes I really find students have not updated it. They haven't completely filled it out. So I'm hoping I'm getting that across, how important that is. You want to edit your visibility and what's displayed. I always say green to be seen. Everything should be green. And that's especially if you're in that job search mode, you're an open networker, you're looking for sales lead, and have that public on the left side there. Make sure you have that checked. And again, the edit the visibility in the upper right-hand corner where it's near to where you edit your URL. So spend 15 minutes a day growing your network. And you do that through going on your homepage feed. Just maybe you don't want to do it daily. Maybe you're going to do it a couple times a week, once a week. But you got to spend time on LinkedIn in order to grow your network. You want to send connection requests. You want to make sure you have a personal note with that connection request, and how did you meet that person, and what event maybe did you meet with them? So add those personal notes when you're connecting. Connect with colleagues, previous colleagues, current colleagues, classmates, alumni, and people you meet in various places. Anyone can be an opportunity to grow your network on LinkedIn. Post comments and show your expertise by posting comments on other people's profiles and on your own. Post conferences, you can post events, as well as share your business tips, achievements, promotions, all that. I see some people are so up on LinkedIn. I admire them. They're doing such a great job. If they get a promotion, they post it on LinkedIn. So you really, the more you're active on it, the better. Follow companies. And these are, again, some overall LinkedIn tips that I just want to mention, that to engage in the group section, connect with individuals under my network. LinkedIn has suggestions and others that you could connect with. So connect them, send them a note, review your notifications when you get in there and you start spending your time. Look at your notifications, follow influencers in your specific industry, and request and give recommendations. So if you ask for a recommendation, maybe give someone else a recommendation, and it's a win-win situation. Utilize that advanced search feature to find individuals, whether they're someone you want to connect with for your job search, maybe a sales lead, but there is such great information under that advanced search where you can find recruiters at companies and all kinds of good stuff. So connect again with recruiters at the jobs that you want to apply to. Is really important. You can usually find them within the organization under that advanced search feature. And again, use that open to work feature if you're not working, and that shows recruiters that you are looking, currently seeking. Walsh College has a career services LinkedIn page. I know Katie manages. Join, connect with us, connect with Katie and I. And again, we are here to help you develop a top-notch LinkedIn profile. So in summary, bring it back to the career fair and just We want you to be successful at our events. Make an appointment with us. We will help you in any way we can through updating your profile on Walsh CareerLink, making sure that email is active, updating your resume, your LinkedIn profile, your elevator pitch, and attend career services events. That's how you're going to meet with employers and really get out there and network. And here's our contact information. We've got your phone, and you can email career services or give us a call to make an individual appointment. I hope if you need further assistance, that will be your next step, is to make an appointment with us. Okay, that concludes our presentation. I really want to thank all of you for joining us today.